Hello and welcome to the final episode of Living Black for 2014. I'm Carla Grant. In today's program, calls for the PM to intervene over the possible closures of remote Indigenous communities.
How governments can believe that it is important to support non-Indigenous communities but not support Indigenous communities.
A new program creating opportunities for Indigenous youth in far north Queensland.
We both went on to play in the grand final this year, which was sort of a big achievement, something that we didn't plan out.
And students showcase their talents 30,000 feet in the air. But first, there are concerns for the survival of some Indigenous communities in Western Australia. Over 1,000 Indigenous residents who live in 274 communities across the state stand to lose basic essential services. While federal and state governments fight over who's responsible for the funding of these communities, their future hangs in the balance. Hannah Hollis reports.
This was once a thriving community in Western Australia's Kimberley region. Umbulgari is more than 2,000 kilometres from Perth, and 3 years ago it was closed by the WA government.
There was no proper consultation with community, past and present community members, about the decisions that were being made.
Its 100 residents were forced to leave their homes and seek refuge in bigger towns across the state.
In closing the community, the problems and the issues have just moved to Wyndham and to other communities. We have more kids, you know, being exposed to, I guess, at a broader scale, and bringing, you know, a lot of the issues that they were faced with over in Umbulgari back to the major towns.
The decision to close the community came after a 2007 coronial inquest into Aboriginal deaths in the region, which revealed high levels of suicide, sexual abuse and child neglect. Amnesty International says it can be highly traumatic for residents being forced to leave their homelands.
So if they deny us the right to live on our homelands, then that denies us the right to be who we are, to have our identity. That will carry on for generations.
There are more than 250 remote communities across Western Australia that are home to more than 12,000 Indigenous people. Umbulgari closed in 2011, but it seems it isn't the only area likely to face this future. Recently, the Western Australian government announced up to 150 of those communities have been deemed unviable, and the Barnett government says there's no other option than to close them down.
It's like history repeating itself, and I just think right now more of our Aboriginal leaders need to start stepping up to the mark and really getting involved with these discussions.
The controversial announcement comes after the federal government revealed it would not provide further funds for essential services, including power and water, beyond June next year. In accepting a $90 million funding package from the Commonwealth, it says it's the responsibility of the Western Australian government to provide those services to remote communities.
We're not paying them to deliver for 3 years. We've given them a lump sum of money. They can put it in their pocket, they can spend it on leafy suburbs, they can do what they like with it. It's untied. But it is calculated on the basis of providing identical services as we have for the next 3 years.
In a statement to Living Black, the WA government said it wishes it didn't have to close any communities, but in reality, it's inevitable. Kirsty Parker, co-chair of the National Congress for Australia's First Peoples, says she was shocked to learn of the community closures.
This is the sort of stuff that makes our people sick. It makes people worry, it makes them feel vulnerable, it makes them feel unsupported. It makes them wonder how governments can believe that it is important to support non-Indigenous communities, but not support Indigenous communities, and how that is actually fair.
There are also concerns the move could violate the human rights of the residents impacted by the closures.
All people in Western Australia should be looked after and managed and serviced by the state government. To make a difference between one community and another purely on their race, in my view, is genocidal.
While the state and federal governments argue about who's responsible for the communities affected, Kirsty Parker is calling for all stakeholders to find a solution.
It is insufficient for the federal minister to say this is a state responsibility, just as it is inadequate for state governments to say, well, we don't have the funds to take care of people. Governments need to sort this out and provide some assurances to our people.
While the WA government has not yet released details on specific communities that may be affected, residents fear the consequences could be wide-ranging.
If we don't do anything about this now, all other remote communities are going to be closed down. And this is what's happening.
The state government has said the closures would not stop Aboriginal people from returning to country, but if they choose to do so, there would not be any government-funded services available. While federal funds remain in place until the end of June 2015, the future looks bleak for those communities affected by these proposed closures.
Still to come on Living Black, educational and sporting opportunities for students in far north Queensland.
A kid from a community like Ingenue with 600 people can do anything that they want to do, go to uni, play in the AFL.
You're watching Living Black. A boarding house in Cairns is changing the lives of young Indigenous men in far north Queensland. AFL Cape York House is working towards creating a new generation of Indigenous leaders, both on and off the field. Laura Murphy Oates reports.
It's just after dawn in Cairns, and the boys at Cape York House are already out of bed. Their Friday morning training routine is not for the faint-hearted. Combining AFL drills with regular fitness, it's all part of the healthy lifestyle that the house promotes.
If we can provide the tools, if you like, or the opportunities for young people to learn, I'm going to be the happiest man going.
Rick Hanlon is the man behind this ambitious project, which takes in over 30 Indigenous boys from all around Cape York and the Torres Strait, providing them with a home away from home while they attend high school here in Cairns. It's taken over a decade to bring AFL, the federal and state governments, and the local community all on board. But now the house is up and running. And it's clear this program is much more than a recruitment drive for the code.
Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, as we know, are 2.7% of the population, yet we derive 9% of our AFL list from that small community. And there is a giving back component.
Every day, the boys set about a routine of regular fitness, school tutoring, and are encouraged to undertake work experience.
And some of those people are absolute AFL nuts. And then there's some people in our crew that don't even like AFL. But so as long as we get the best for our young men, that's all I care about.
After breakfast, it's off to school, with the boys attending a mix of private and public schools around the city. For 17-year-old Glendon Woosup, it's his last week of high school. He was one of the first boys to come to Cape York House 2 years ago when it first opened. Now he's heading off to university and is training with the Gold Coast Suns AFL team.
So I knew that I'd get support here, which is why I came here. But after being here for 2 years now, it wasn't what I expected. It's actually more, because what they do here, they give more. So they go over and beyond what their job description says.
Glendon has excelled on and off the field as a public speaker and as president of the Cape York Eagles. Yeah, I'm on my game all day. It's a new club founded by the house and Australia's first club run by high school students.
We both went on to play in the grand final this year, which was sort of a big achievement, something that we didn't plan out to happen. We were going to be competitive, but we didn't think that we'd be there dancing on the big stage on the last day.
He says his young cousins back home in the small town of Ingenue are keen to follow in his footsteps.
That's probably the reason why I want to succeed in life. A kid from a community like Ingenue with 600 people can do anything that they want to do, go to uni or play in the AFL.
But Rick says it hasn't been all smooth sailing for many of the boys.
We've got kids from all walks of life here. We've got kids with great upbringings down to kids that have really struggled, and their families have struggled, and And, you know, we've got probably 6 to 8 boys in our group that have lost an immediate parent before the age of 8.
Rachel Elphick runs the nightly tutoring program, bringing in volunteers from the local university.
A lot of the boys come with no experience of having to do homework. They don't know what they're capable of, and it's not until you actually provide structure and support for them that they can actually see that there's no reason why further education isn't part of their plan.
Education Queensland has placed Rachel here to oversee the boys' education, but her role has developed into much more.
They're putting in 100% effort. They're here, they're away from family. They need as much support as they can possibly get, and you don't care whether it's, you know, the odd phone call, I'm hungry, I forgot my lunch. It's not just a job, it's an actual, you know, you become part of the family.
13-year-old Munro made the journey to Cairns from Porama, a remote island in the Torres Strait with a population of only 180 people.
First I felt homesick, and then I realised that it's normal and I had to move on.
Creole. Yeah, that's actually my first language. I'm used to speaking Creole because I was brought up in the Torres Strait. There's lots of opportunities, and there's the tutors, they come in every night, every weekdays, which helps us on our English.
While Munro is unsure of his AFL potential, he says his time at Cape York House has made him fitter and healthier.
I always wanted to lose some weight and develop new skills.
He's also got clear goals for a career.
When I grow up, I just want to work, in the mines as a mechanic and, like, to help my family and stuff.
For Indigenous people from very remote areas in their early 20s, just under 40% have completed high school. For the boys of Cape York House, coming here to Cairns is a chance to buck that trend.
Tonight is a special house graduation night for the Year 12s. Not only are they all finishing high school, but 4 of the 6 are going to university next year.
It would be wonderful to have a girls' program. What Rick Hanlon and the team here have done at AFL Cape York with these young men is just extraordinary.
Proud mum Audrey Mosby has travelled all the way from Thursday Island to see her son Ezra graduate.
He's a great role model for his siblings. Yeah, I'm so proud of him.
I will be the first person in my family to graduate and go to university. Rachel, I couldn't have done this without you.
Honestly, I could go on all night about each and every one of the people that have assisted me on my journey thus far.
I want them to all grow old and tell their families their stories. And that is a part of, you know, starting at AFL Cape York House and what happened there.
For some of the boys, a big future in AFL is ahead. But for all of them, the house is the start of something better.
Katoomba in the Blue Mountains of New South Wales is home to the Gunungurra and Darug peoples. More recently, it played host to nations from around the world for a global Indigenous gathering. Ryan Little has more.
Held in the Blue Mountains of New South Wales, the gathering played host to over 300 delegates representing more than 40 countries, including Canada, Kenya, Chile and Iran.
Taking responsibility for those resources.
Learning about best practices in the conservation of nature and culture is what brings these people together. The important role of traditional owners was also recognised.
Who has kept it so wonderful and lovely and ecologically perfect and all that? The people who've been living there and protecting it and using it sustainably.
Targi says most countries don't support the use of traditional Indigenous knowledge in developing conservation programs, but praises Australia's leadership in the area.
The dominant idea is that you don't kick out the Indigenous peoples to protect the land. You'd recognise their own conservation values and efforts, and you support them if you want. I would say one kind of that sort of thing is the whole IPA or Indigenous Protected Areas in Australia, from which we can learn a lot. But the IPA is a limited concept. Why? Because it's a government project. The government in Australia has been wise enough to approve a bunch of money and say, we will help Indigenous peoples protect, you know, land, and will help them and pay them if necessary.
Daniel Odes from the Kimberley Land Council says IPAs provide an opportunity to look after both country and the people living on it.
Indigenous protected areas are really driven from the community, and they're also, you create plans of management to international standards and done with the prior informed consent of the community as well, but obviously taking into account all of your natural resources and cultural resources in country and putting them in the priority list of management rather than the other way around, which might be a government construct of managing countries.
Kenyan man Wilson Kipgan is from the Rift Valley region of East Africa. He says his country could learn from Australia's practices after his people were removed from their land in the late 1940s.
Over 40 years ago, my community lost land for conservation. And the people who were evicted from the land were not compensated, neither given alternative land. Neither have they been benefiting from the proceeds that are received from the tourism venture.
Wilson is critical of Kenya's treatment of its Indigenous peoples, and like Australia, it must make Aboriginal concerns paramount when planning its conservation efforts.
Conservation is good when you involve the Indigenous communities, but you don't deprive the Indigenous communities so that you create a leisure or a tourist resort for purposes of creating money for the country. But the country must start from the community which has conserved the nature and the wildlife which has been there for many years.
Balancing economic development was an issue raised throughout the forum, along with maintaining cultural values and the environment.
They have to deal with extractivism, mining, infrastructure, and this fight is very common.
From Africa to the Americas, many challenges for the world's Indigenous peoples remain the same. But it's hoped that gatherings like this will help solve the global issues faced by First Nations peoples.
Still to come on Living Black, concerns over the declining rate of Indigenous health workers in the top end.
When you see a profession that should be growing actually diminishing in size, that is alarming.
You're watching Living Black. Health services in the Northern Territory are concerned over the rapid decline of Indigenous health practitioners. A new initiative aimed at boosting Aboriginal participation hopes to create a new generation of health workers. Laura Murphy Oates reports.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Good. Hello.
That's good. Do you want to grab a seat over there while Len gets blood pressure checked?
Ben Halls is a 41-year-old Noorunga and Martinamere man from South Australia. Working here at the Central Australian Aboriginal Congress Clinic in Alice Springs, he's one of over 200 Aboriginal health practitioners throughout the Northern Territory.
My blood pressure is good.
In the Territory, where 30% of the population is Indigenous, Ben's profession is helping to bridge the gap between the community and health services. On top of regular health work, they also act as translators and advocates for the Indigenous community, and they're a familiar face amongst a revolving door of medical staff in remote areas.
Just a friend. Sometimes you're an educator and a teacher, a doctor, nurse, psychologist. I think we do it all.
But the number of registered health practitioners is quickly declining in the Northern Territory, falling by 30% between 2000 and 2010.
When you see a profession that should be growing actually diminishing in size, that is alarming.
Most of the AHPs that I know were all over 40. So, and my mentors all retired.
In 2012, the role of AHPs went national, allowing them to work across state borders. But the standard for clinical skills and registration is now set much higher. Ben Halls believes that, and the extra cost of training, has driven people away.
Financially, not a lot of Indigenous people have the family back up, supported by a partner and family. whereas other people don't have that option.
The NT Health Minister says they're taking control of the situation, with the government committing to raising Aboriginal health practitioner levels by 10% each year, starting with remote communities like Wadare and Papunya.
There was an immediate response. For example, in Wadare, we had a number of former health workers that aren't trained as practitioners as yet put up their hands and say, we want to be a part of this. We want to get back into the health service and start serving our people on community like we used to.
There's a crisis out there, and having acknowledged that and seeking representation of Congress onto this task force really recognises the expertise and experience that we've had on the ground.
Donna Archie is on the Back on Track task force, charged with reinvigorating the profession. She says lack of training options is an issue, with funding for on-the-ground training sparse.
Congress currently uses its service delivery money, which is an historical decision to do that, to train Aboriginal health practitioners.
At the Congress Clinic, Ben is training Lenny Cooper, a Yorta Yorta man and former teacher from Victoria.
One, two, three.
Lenny is reaching the end of a long haul.
A few year and a half I've been doing the bookwork for the Cert 4, and now I'm doing clinical hours, which is 900. The Cert 4, I've got a job for as long as I want to, so I'm really glad.
For Ben, training new practitioners is a necessity.
I think it's important to keep the cultural awareness and cultural significance going.
And his hopes rest on the next generation of Aboriginal health practitioners.
A group of talented high school students from around the country have been given the chance of a lifetime. 16 Indigenous students were treated to a world-first sky-high mentoring session with some of Australia's most influential entertainment industry experts. Nevenka McEwen has more.
Yeah, buddy. It's an opportunity that doesn't come by often. The chance to showcase their performing art talent and compete in a nationwide online competition. AIME’s GOT GAME.
AIME’s GOT GAME is one of our sessions that we run from year 7 all the way through to year 12 for our Indigenous high school kids. And the main focus of this one is to show these kids how much talent their peers have, how much the next generation of Indigenous kids have energy, excitement and talent that they can share with the nation as well. And if we push them outside their comfort zones, they get up and they rap or they sing or they dance or play the trumpet, then it actually gives these kids a chance when they go back into class to have even more confidence in themselves and who they are.
And little did they know that they were about to embark on a charter flight for the world's first mentoring session in the sky. More than 65,000 votes were received in the inaugural competition, which included 45 performance acts. And for those performers, finishing in the top 10 led to a trip of a lifetime.
You feel this, you believe this, I'm the wolf type, but the rappers can't.
We're lucky to have industry mentors, and a lot of them are Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander and have succeeded themselves in music or arts or dance, so people from Bangarra and some fantastic musicians as well. The reason why they're there is to be able to share their stories with the kids.
The Virgin Islands lady's like, yeah, you'll be sitting next to Denny Clayton. And I was like, what, Denny Clayton? She's like, yeah, and I was like, oh my God.
The excitement didn't end there for this 16-year-old from Western Australia.
He was my mentor, so like we sat together and he helped me through the booklet that they gave us. And because he works like in the music industry and stuff, he asked me what kind of bands I was listening to at the moment. And he gave me like bands that he would recommend that I listen to along with the songs and stuff. And it was awesome.
With sessions from some of Australia's most influential industry mentors, including Nat King Cole's nephew Lionel Cole and Busby Maru, the students got down to doing what they do best, performing.
The one that I got was Sydney. Now he's pretty cool. He taught me and all this like history stuff about like how he got into dance and how much it means to him. And he's really passionate about it. And he wants to help with like younger kids, like all ages, and just express themselves and the culture through dance. And I think that's pretty cool.
Sydney Saltner is one of the mentors assigned to the students in the Showstopper category, and through his many years with Bangarra, he knows what it takes to bring out the best in his performers.
We wanted the kids to create a piece about their identity and empowerment of themselves, and
also teaching them that they're the next generation of leaders. It's about taking ownership of who you are as a person, but ownership of your language, your culture. So I'm from the Woolly tribe in Queensland, so it's about taking that and writing it all over the place, and that's what this piece is about. It's about reclaiming that name for yourself as a person and give you a sense of pride.
We can go back home now and like share our experiences with the other people, and they can learn from us.
Open your eyes, reach for the sky.
And across the city, the other group of performers were getting first-hand experience of recording in a studio, writing and recording the AIME anthem. One of the youngest students in the competition was 14-year-old Bailey Ballard.
It's my most important for Indigenous students to believe in themselves. Don't be afraid of who you are, don't be ashamed of who you are, and just to follow your dreams.
Elena Levitikos was grateful for the opportunity.
It's been really good and, like, professional as well. Like, just us bunch of kids writing a song.
Elena's mentor was well-respected Brisbane-based hip-hop artist Kayla Tyson.
They really give us something back as well, and it inspires me as a musician to see these kids getting in and seeing people, you know, in the studio and reminding us of how it felt for the first time.
They've rehearsed for many hours and now it's come down to this. These students continue to aim high and reach for the sky to be the stars of tomorrow.
Thanks for joining us for the last episode for 2014. You can also watch any of our episodes again by visiting our website. We leave you with some memorable moments from the Living Black team. On behalf of all of us, I'm Carla Grant, wishing you a very Merry Christmas and a safe New Year. See you next time.
Okay, so this is where I have to be listening yeah, very attentively.
Well, it may be the end of the line of the planning.
The world's greatest works. No! Sorry, I've got to start doing it again.
Ooh!
Oh, God.
38.5%.
Warning.
And major art. Oh, major two art.
Da-da-da.
Next up.
Wait for that car.
Okay, that's good.
What is that flavour? Kind of minty.
We love watching Living Black.